Welcome, very well done for making it here in our true British summer. Now it's started. You must have thought you were somewhere else in the last couple of days, but it's lovely and sunny in August. It's the final day of the World Humanist Congress, and I'm delighted to be chairing this session. I'm Naomi Phillips, I'm a trustee of the British Humanist Association. I'm also chair of Labour Humanists, which is a voluntary, political, small but fast-growing group trying to help make the Labour Party in the UK more ethical and equal and secular. I'm really delighted to be introducing this panel and chairing it. We've got some really amazing speakers, and it's just wonderful to see so many of you here. And we're hoping that this should be a fairly informal, really nice interactive session. It's Sunday morning, we're going to try a nice light subject like politics to get us going. And the session is called Should Humanism Matter in Politics? So I'm just going to introduce the session a bit. I'm going to introduce our speakers. Each of our speakers is going to speak from their own perspective. Just for five to 10 minutes. We're going to open it out probably to the panel to let them pick up anything that they really agree or very much disagree with that someone else has said. And then I'm just really keen to open it out to you for comments and questions and to get some discussion going this morning. And I'll speak a bit slower, sorry. This session is called Should Humanism Matter in Politics? And when we were thinking about putting the session together, we're really thinking about in the context of the theme for this conference, which is freedom of expression. And it's always quite difficult when it comes to politics, I think, because sometimes we really want politicians to say what they really think and be there, but actually they are part of parties and we are, in different countries, and actually do we really want them to be just an individual in an elected chamber doing what they want, or do we want actually them to be representing other political issues? As we know definitely after this weekend, if we were in any doubt, humanists do tend to be staunch defenders of human rights, including freedom of speech and expression, of the prohibition of discrimination, and indeed humanist organisations, which most of you, or many of you, are represented here today, around the world put human rights at the very forefront of their campaigning work, and they're often very vocal when states seek to violate those rights of people. But I think it's fair to say that humanists in elected chambers, so in parliaments, tend to have a bit of a patchier record. So some are outspoken and reference their humanist outlook, in favour of science and equality and human rights. But others vote through, or sometimes don't oppose, legislation which we might not like, such as on discrimination by faith schools in this country is one example. Or legislation which seeks to put limits on free speech in some way. Does it matter? Do we want religion or belief to be a personal and private matter, or do we want our elected representatives to vote according to their political beliefs and to their conscience? And if we want humanists to vote according to their beliefs, what does that mean for religious parliamentarians? Do we want them to be able to do the same or not? Essentially, should religion or belief be a private matter when it comes to politics? I'm delighted to have such a fantastic panel with me today. Speaking first will be Tom Copley, who is a fellow trustee of the British Humanist Association. He's an elected member of the London Assembly, which holds our elected mayor to account. And he's got a really interesting background working in fighting racism and for equality and for LGBT rights and a whole host of other things. We've got Maggie from the American Humanist Association. I'm sure you've seen her around at this conference. She is a Director of Development and Communications. That's not what I meant, but and she edits the AHA's weekly e-zine Humanist Network News, and she's appeared in the Washington Post and the Huffington Post and the Voice of America to discuss humanism and other related issues. Sitting next to her, I'm really delighted that we have Kerry McCarthy, who is a Labour Member of Parliament. She's been the MP for Bristol East since 2005, and she's now also a Shadow Foreign Office Minister, covering UK relations with the Far East and Southeast Asia, India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, the Caribbean, and Latin America. And her, really importantly, her portfolio also includes international human rights, including freedom of religion and belief. And last, but definitely not least, is Julie Pernet. who works as a policy and advocacy officer at the European Humanist Federation and the I should be able to pronounce this, Centre d'Action Lake, which promotes humanism and secularism in French-speaking Belgium. So I'd like to give my panel a very warm welcome, and then we'll ask Tom to come up.
Hello, good morning. Yeah, sometimes when I'm sat in Mayor's Question Time with Boris Johnson, I do wish for divine intervention. Should humanism matter in politics? I want to start by talking about an argument I had with some friends of mine on Twitter yesterday, because everything happens on Twitter these days. They're atheists, they're left-wing, they're members of the Labour Party. Not that necessarily qualifies you of left-wing, but these particular friends of mine are. And they objected to something that I had retweeted from this conference, which is a quote someone said saying, offence isn't taken, it's given, which I thought was rather neat. And they started to essentially have a go at atheists, even though they're fellow atheists. And one of them said, why do atheists need to have a conference? Why do you need to get together and have a conference? Is it just a case of saying, do we believe in God? No, okay, well, that's it. And I thought to myself, if you substituted atheists with any religion, I think people would take quite a bit of offence at that, actually. And it kind of proved the point why we do need to have this sort of conference, when there are these sort of attitudes toward atheism, even amongst atheists themselves, and on the British political left, because I feel that it's become quite fashionable in some sections of the left to have a go at atheists and humanists when we express our beliefs. So I think that this debate about the role of humanism in politics is very timely. I think in general, we can't discuss the role of humanism in politics without also talking about the role of faith in politics and how politicians who have faith, how they express themselves in the political arena. I think that in Britain we're, in general, quite uncomfortable with politicians overtly expressing their religious beliefs. I mean, famously, of course, during an interview, Tony Blair was interrupted by Alistair Campbell when he was asked about his faith, and Alistair Campbell said, well, we don't do God. Similarly, when Tony Blair wanted to end his when he made a big speech when he stood down as Prime Minister, he wanted to end it with God bless Britain. And a civil servant turned to him and said, Prime Minister, this isn't America. I think that... Maggie might have something to say about that later on. I think that we are uncomfortable with it. I mean, we had two atheist Prime Ministers in the 20th century and no one really remarked upon it at all. If the polling is anything to go by, we're going to have another race, the atheist Prime Minister, next year. It's not something that particularly concerns or bothers people. But when, for example, David Cameron stands up and talks about Britain as a Christian country, I think it does jar with people. Partly because I think people look at it and think, well, you're just doing that for cynical, opportunistic reasons. You're not doing it because you actually believe in it. So I think in general in the political arena, people are uncomfortable with this kind of thing. Now, as humanists, or any person with strong convictions or beliefs, when you're in the political world, you're inevitably going to be guided by those beliefs. And I think that's completely unavoidable, and that's absolutely natural. If you hold a very strong belief, whether it's religious or non-religious, that is going to filter through into your actions in the political world. But I think there's a very big difference between being guided by your values and attempting to impose those values on other people. And I think that's a distinction that we have to draw. So, for example, I have friends who are in politics who have very strong Christian beliefs. And, for example, they would say, well, I personally will never have an abortion because I think it's wrong. But I wouldn't limit the right of other people to choose to have, or other women, I should say, sorry, to choose to have an abortion if that is their choice. And you can extend that to all sorts of moral issues. I think that's a very clear distinction we need to make. I think it's easier for us as humanists, because as humanists we try not to impose our value system on other people. We talk about the ethical framework that we have, the ethical framework that guides us, but we don't attempt to impose that on other people. I think that's a very clear distinction that we need to make. So I think as humanists, we should talk about our values and why we've reached those values, and the fact that we've reached those values and the decisions, the moral and ethical decisions that we make through rational thought and debate. And I think we should talk about that. There's one thing in politics, I'll just finish off with this, because it's something that annoys me, and Kerry would know much more about this being issues in Parliament, and that's the issue of free votes in Parliament. Now, most votes, as I'm sure you know, in Parliament, MPs are whipped, and if they want to vote against the party line, they have to rebel against the whip, and if they're a minister, they have to resign. There are certain issues and certain times when MPs are essentially given a get-out-of-jail-free card. You can vote against the party line on a certain issue, and it's what they describe as moral issues. And what interests me is how we determine what a moral issue is, because they tend to be things that relate to sex and women's reproductive rights, which are the moral issues that particularly concern the church and other religions. So, for example, stem cell research or abortion or gay rights. These are the things that tend to fall under a free vote. Now, I would argue that almost any vote in Parliament could be regarded as a moral issue. As a humanist, I might take exception to being told I had to vote for cuts for social security, for the poorest people in society. But that wouldn't be regarded as a free vote, as a moral issue, and therefore a free vote under the sort of system that we have at the moment. Interestingly enough, war is not a moral issue. War is whipped. But who you want to have sex with at what time and what frequency and what position, that's a moral issue. Where are our priorities on that one? So that's something that particularly concerns me, and I think that it's an example, one of the many examples, of where religious privilege has pervaded into the political world, and I think that we should oppose that. And I would oppose humanist privilege just as much as I would oppose religious privilege. I think we need a level playing field. I don't think any belief system should be prioritized over any other. But I do think that as humanists, just as people who are religious will talk about their own religious beliefs and how that guides them, I do think as humanists we should speak up about our value system and why we've reached the ethical and moral decisions that we've reached. Thank you very much.
Please do use the WHC2014 hashtag, but also very specially for this session, we have our own hashtag, which is WHCpolitics. So if you are tweeting along the process, thank you so much.
And yes, please tweet me. I love when I'm cited on Twitter. I'm one of those totally annoying self. Narcissistic. Say it louder. I'm also a very loud American. I'm going to speak very loudly so people in the back can hear me and try to speak as slowly as I possibly can. I'll start with just a quick story. I visited London for the first time back in 2010. And the morning we came in, I discovered that the British Humanist Association meeting building was just two blocks from our hostel where Roy and I stayed. And so we hadn't taken a shower, we just got off the plane, but we wanted to go and visit and see it. And Andrew Copson was there, and he was so gracious and so nice. Oh, you British people are so nice and wonderful. Oh, it's great. And because if somebody showed up at our door, we would have been like, what are you doing here? Get out of here. And so he was nice, and so we sat in his office and we talked. And we're Americans, so we wanted to brag about the American Humanist Association and all of our successes and accomplishments. And so we, at the time, in 2010, we had one atheist in Congress, Representative Pete Stark from California, as some of you know. And so we were telling Andrew, so we just found out that we have an atheist in Congress, and he's a member of the American Humanist Association. Yeah, we're doing great. And so Andrew says, oh yeah, that's very nice. I'm doing a bad British accent. That's very nice. Yeah, we have 150 members of Parliament who are humanists. And I said, okay. So we're really behind when it comes to humanism and politics, but luckily things are really moving in the right direction. Studies have shown that 14% of Americans don't believe in an intervening God, okay? Now that's more than Muslims, Jews, Mormons, and Pentecostalists combined. It's more than the LGBT numbers in the United States. It's more than most ethnic minorities. Humanists, atheists, and non-believers are in fact one of the largest minority groups in the United States, but you wouldn't know it based on our organized numbers or our political power. And of course, despite the fact that we have a First Amendment that clearly separates church and state, the religious right is really moving forward to essentially rebrand the United States as a Christian nation. They're really reinforcing In God We Trust and money, and using that as a foundation for our Christian values and beliefs. In God We Trust is now being put on public buildings. It's being put on war memorials to tie it to patriotism. Children in public schools recite the Pledge of Allegiance, which includes one nation under God, so they have to reinforce the God belief. And of course, as Tom had mentioned, if President Obama forgets to say "In God," or "God Bless America" after the end of a speech, it's actually scandalous. It makes the news when he doesn't say it. So this is a serious problem, this God. God is essentially everywhere in the United States. But it goes a little more serious than that. There's also a lot of religious exemptions that allow parents to choose to not have their children have vaccinations or even have medical care. You know, Christian Scientists, they don't believe in going to hospitals. And you parents don't have to be punished for that. You don't have to get arrested for that, even if the child dies. And just recently, we've decided that corporations have religious beliefs now. And so they can refuse to offer birth control to their employers. They can refuse to fund blood transfusions or any kind of medical act that they don't want to do because it goes against their religious beliefs. The Supreme Court has just decided that corporations can now do that. So it's become very serious. And of course, there's all kinds of other problems. There's still creationism being taught in public schools that taxpayers are funding. There's the parsonage allowance, which allows ministers to write off, you know, $1.2 billion a year. These are special benefits that religious people have over non-religious people. And then, of course, anti-atheist sentiment in the United States is pretty strong. It can be measured. It can be observed. Eight states have laws on the books that prohibit atheists from holding public office. Now, this isn't enforceable, okay? However, it would take an act of a state representative to remove it from the books, which no state representative is willing to do, okay? 53% of Americans, the largest percentage, are least likely to vote for an atheist for president. That's in last place behind any religious belief. In fact, atheist candidates are worse than someone who has never held office, has been divorced twice, or has an extramarital affair. Apparently we're that evil. Survey respondents associate atheism with criminal behavior, extreme materialism, and elitism. And the majority of Americans believe that atheists do not agree with their vision of America, disapprove of an atheist joining a family and marriage, and believe that God is necessary for raising moral children. So the social discrimination is still very prevalent in the United States. And I know that we've heard from a lot of wonderful people at this conference from developing countries and all parts of the world where it's very serious. You know, they can be killed for their atheism and they really have to hide. And so that's far more serious. I definitely agree. So I just want to at least clarify that. But this is just some of the information that's going on in the U.S. You can still get fired for being an atheist. Students are being bullied for being an atheist. People are being kicked out of their homes for being an atheist or a humanist. So how do we fix this? I would argue that we have to get involved politically. I think it would be impossible for us to really start making the gains that we really want to see if we're not essentially putting our money where our mouth is and voting for people who are humanists and atheists and stand for our progressive values. I think that this is very crucial. If we properly mobilize our numbers, then our elected leaders would have absolutely no choice but to recognize our powerful voting bloc and hear what we have to say. Humanist voters want to protect the principle of church-state separation. We don't want to see our taxpayer dollars spent on faith-based programs or supporting churches. Voters want politicians that will stand up against the religious right, that will work to characterize this country as a Christian nation. But most of all, humanist voters just want respectability and equality for non-theists in America. Now, the American Humanist Association, we recognize the need to lobby and get involved politically. And so our offices for many years was in Amherst, New York. And we moved to Washington, D.C. in 2001. So we've been there for over a decade. And we first started out by joining coalition groups. We were working with religious progressive groups in Washington, D.C. on LGBT marriage, on women's rights, on environment issues, so that they would know from the humanist perspective, we really stand for ethics and morals, and we get involved more in issues other than simply the God question. You know, we're not here to debate religion, we're not here to make fun of religion. We're actually here to make sure that women have equal rights, that LGBT people have equal rights. This is what we really stand for. And that reputation has really helped us in many ways. For example, we were the first organization to sponsor a resolution bill in Congress, the Darwin Day resolution. This was in 2011. And I encourage you to do this if you can do this in your countries as well, introduce bills that support Darwin Day to recognize Charles Darwin's birthday on February 12th. And that was, again, Pete Stark, who was the atheist in Congress that was affiliated with us. And this was something that, you know, a lot of other types of groups can join too, science groups, progressive religious groups. It was a way to bring us all together. This wasn't an atheist resolution. This was a pro-science resolution that humanists were advocating for. And it helped us get the word out. It helped us get a lot more known to politicians. You know, we've also done a few things. We have something in the United States called the National Day of Prayer in May, where they try to make everybody pray on that day. And we try to remind them that not everybody prays, and there's a very significant number of people who don't. And so we countered that with a day called the National Day of Reason. And we actually had two members of Congress support that with a proclamation. So, you know, these are small numbers. We've only got one person, two people here, but what's great about this is that it will start to grow. We're at least getting through the door, and we're trying to make inroads, and we're trying to make an impact in that way. So we're really working hard on that. And of course, just recently, we held a congressional briefing to members of Congress and their staff on the need to include a humanist chaplain in the US Armed Forces. We have struggled even to just get humanists recognized as a religious distinction that you can select when you join the military. And we have 3,000 members who identify as a humanist. And that's more than Buddhists who have a chaplain, that's more than Hindus who have a chaplain. They all have chaplains and we have zero. So that's something that we're working on. And then I think that, and one of the important things sort of related to freedom of expression that we've been doing, there's an organization called the International Religious Freedom Roundtable, of which the AHA is one of the sole active atheist members of the group. And being involved in that group, which is focused on religious freedom abroad, has helped open doors for us as well. I was able to speak to the State Department about atheist discrimination, and in their annual report, they, for the first time, included atheist discrimination. They hadn't before. And also, I did a training program for Foreign Service officers at the State Department to let them know that they can reach out to humanist communities that are in the countries that they're working in. So this is all really important, and this actually came about because of the Freedom of Belief report that IHEU puts out. And so I really encourage you to take that report, especially if you're in the developing world. It's a great way to talk to your elected officials. It's a great way to get involved in government. So I strongly encourage that. We already know of at least 24 members of Congress who have told us privately that they don't believe in God, but they won't come out, of course. And if we tried to out them, they would deny it. We do have one member of Congress who for the first time wrote none next to her religious affiliation, N-O-N-E, not N-U-N. none, as in no religious affiliation. But we currently have no open atheists or open humanists in Congress, and I think that this absolutely needs to change. And so we do need to do more than just lobby, by the way. So I've been talking about lobbying, and I've been talking about getting involved. And if there's anything that you're gonna write down, I really strongly encourage you to write this down. This is the first political action committee formed to fund atheist and humanist candidates running for public office. And it's called the Free Thought Equality Fund, okay? This is huge, okay? So we're now starting to actually, like I said, put our money where our mouth is. Encourage atheists to run for public office, encourage them to stand for humanist principles, and then actually give them money. You would be surprised how much money it takes for a politician to do something for you, really. $1,000, like, not in an inappropriate way, but it's amazing. I mean, you really think, like, $1,000, you know, that's a lot of money, sure, but it's amazing. Your politician will listen to you, they will really take your word into consideration and do a lot for humanists and atheists. So this is, when we learned this, we said, okay, well, we need to start doing this now. We need to start getting more politically involved and actually be funding these candidates. And what's great about the Free Thought Equality Fund, too, is that we're also funding religious leaders as well, if they stand for humanist principles, like support for the environment, like support for women, like support for LGBT people, and support for church-state separation as well. So we're not just funding atheist candidates, we're funding religious candidates as well that really support us. So, you know, I would say it's not just enough to get involved in government, to get involved in politics. We really need to actually elect more people who stand for what we believe in. The Christian movement in the United States, they have billions and billions of dollars. And they're doing the exact same thing. And we have to do it too. We have to do what they're doing if we're going to in any way be a viable force and actually make the change that we want to see. You know, if we want to actually ensure that women have free reproductive access and access to abortion, then we need to vote based on that. If we want to have all 50 states have equal LGBT marriage and have that recognized in all 50 states, we need to do that. And we need to elect people that stand for that. If we want people to support evolution and support science and make sure that our kids in school get the proper education that they need, we need to support those type of candidates. And if we care about economic justice, and this is a big issue in the United States, especially with the Tea Party and Republicans and the libertarian movement, if we care about economic justice, then we have to care about the poor, we have to care about the elderly, and we have to care about children. And that is one of the most core humanistic values that we absolutely need to support. Humanism is more than just a lack of belief in God. It's a value system. It's a value system that we should vote based on. So it is our duty to vote, it's our duty to get more people in office in order to turn American society, hopefully, into one that respects non-believers, atheists, and humanists. Thank you very much. And may the flying spaghetti monster bless you all. What's the equivalent? The pink unicorn? Okay.
Good morning, everybody. Can you hear me? No? Okay. I have a live voice, so I'm sorry. And I have a very strong French accent also. So at EHF, European Humanist Federation, we also get involved into politics, but into European politics. And a great deal of our activities is directed towards European Union institutions and the Council of Europe. I mean, to push forward for the adoption of progressive laws, but also to oppose conservative attacks on fundamental rights and to oppose religious extremism, which is very active within the European Union institutions. And so today I'd like to give you some insight into the influence of religion and beliefs within the European Parliament in particular. At least as far as we have experienced it at EHF. So in a paradoxical way, the EU can be seen as a Christian club, but also as a materialistic project without any soul. And, well, is what is being said. The EU has no direct competence regarding religion or beliefs, but it meets religion when discussing a wide range of issues like education, cultural issues, foreign affairs issues, and most of all, ethical issues. And religion and beliefs are quite present and active within the European Parliament, and I would say in three main ways. So first, at the official level, churches, representatives, and non-confessional organizations, which include humanist organizations, have been granted a specific dialogue with EU institutions, which give them a specific access to them. To discuss issues of common interest. And at EHF, we strongly oppose the creation of such a dialogue because we're committed to secularism. And so we thought there was no reason that churches and non-confessional would be granted a specific access to EU politics. But still, this dialogue was created as a result of a strong lobbying from the Vatican and from churches' representatives. So far, we have made sure that this dialogue would be implemented in a fair and equal way. But as far as humanist organizations are concerned, this dialogue has been very disappointing, I'd say. For example, a few years ago, when meeting churches' representative, the vice president of the European Parliament, who was also a former bishop, started and ended the meeting by blessing the whole audience. I mean, it's not very secular, of course. And a few months later, its successor, the vice president of the European Parliament in charge of the dialogue, when meeting humanist organization, EHF, he quoted like four or five times the Bible, and even suggested that atheism could lead to dictatorship. So that doesn't sound very secular either. And this is for the official side, but besides this official side, there is a large number of more or less extremist religious organizations very active within the corridors of the European Parliament. I mean, there are mostly Christian organizations, because other religions are not very much organized at the European level. And these organizations generally hold a very conservative anti-choice agenda, of course. And several of them, I mean, they're crazy guys. They have really aggressive lobbying methods, like the traditional spamming of MEPs, but also insults and personal threats to progressive MEPs, which is crazy. And this past month, there were really like ideological wars within the European Parliament when discussing issues like related to the beginning of life. But most of these organizations are increasingly, they are professionalizing. I mean, they present themselves in a very misleading way to MEPs. Like, they present themselves as human rights defenders, and they have completely hijacked the humanist discourse. Like, they have hijacked religious freedom, human dignity, non-discrimination, and so on. And they have also increasingly used arguments other than ethical arguments, like scientific arguments, juridical arguments, to push forward the agenda. Well, they also have very wide networks, and they have a great capacity to mobilize citizens. A recent example of this, I don't know if you've heard about the European Citizens Initiative, One of Us. It's a very conservative anti-choice initiative, which was organized by an anti-choice Italian organization. It was supported by the Pope, and it was requesting the European Union to protect the human embryo, the unborn life, basically. And this petition collected about 2 million signatures throughout Europe. And as a result of this number of signatures, it was officially presented at the European Parliament. But religion and beliefs are also present in the European Parliament through personal beliefs of MEPs. I mean, we have indeed, for the religious side, a tiny minority of really crazy guys, like very anti-choice MEPs who publicly claim their religious beliefs. And these MEPs work hand in hand with the extremist organization I was talking about. But otherwise, I would say that a vast majority of MEPs remain quite discreet and silent on their personal beliefs. And the French ones, for instance, they are really reluctant to speak about their personal belief. For the humanist side, we can count on several outspoken, open and very active humanists. Like, I don't know if you know her, the Dutch MEP Sophie Invelt, who created a platform within the European Parliament to defend secularism in politics. But we can also count on more discreet MEPs who don't want to be openly labeled as humanists, but who support our positions all the same. Do really believe affects political votes? How can we make sure that beliefs affect political votes? Well, for the tiny visible minority I was talking about, like the crazy ones, it's really clear, I mean, they don't hide, it's really clear that their beliefs really affect their votes. But I think it would be wrong to overestimate the influence of beliefs when explaining political votes, because there are also many other factors which are extremely important, like the party line, the group line, and the national party line. But having said that, I think, like Tom said, in the European Parliament, when MEPs discuss about very sensitive moral issues, like sexual and reproductive rights, like LGBT rights, like stem cell research also, we see that MEPs vote more accordingly to their beliefs, and they can rebel, from their party line. And it happened several times this year. So is it important to have humanists at the European Parliament? I would say that on a strategic ground, it is, because it makes our work easier. Like, we know who our friends are and who are our enemies. But I'd say that, I mean, as a European citizen, for me, it's not so important to know about the beliefs of my representatives. What is important is to know their position on the issues we are interested of, like, I don't know, on societal issues, like how they position on gay rights, how they position on women's rights, gender equality, abortion, freedom of research, education, and so on. And religious or not, what is important is to have people fighting for fundamental rights and above all, opening new freedoms for others. So I will finish here very briefly by speaking about the main challenges for humanists regarding European politics. I think that humanist organization and humanist citizen in general have a great responsibility here to make sure that European decisions are taken on grounds that everyone can agree on, which is democracy, equality, freedom, rule of law, minorities' rights, etc., and not personal belief, not humanist belief, not religious belief, not particular system of value. But I would say also that the big challenge with the increasing extremism, I mean political extremism in Europe, but also religious extremism, is that humanists should regain control over the humanist discourse, regain control about over the humanist concept. And the third point I wanted also to briefly talk about is with this professionalization of extremist religious organization, I mean, we need to build alliances with other progressive human rights defenders, like women's rights organization, LGBT rights organization, reproductive rights organization, and so on. And I'm very happy that DHF has been doing it a lot last year. I think we can't be staying in our, I mean, humanist just field, and we have really to open alliances. Well, that's quite a program, so I'll leave you here.
Thank you.
We've got the usual problem of being not quite tall enough for the podium, but I think that's okay. Thanks for everyone who's spoken already. I'm sure you're all dying to get stuck into the questions and that. So I just want to pick up on some of the things that people have said. And I want to start with what Maggie said about atheism being a value system. Because I think that is not accepted by the vast majority of people that I come into contact with as a Member of Parliament. I think they think that atheism is just about being rude about other people's religion, basically, or being anti something. And I don't really define myself as a humanist, I just say I'm an atheist. But I think the whole humanist movement is perhaps trying to encapsulate the idea there are values involved and it's about believing in something rather than not believing in a deity or believing in a religious faith. I think one of the things that is always said by predominantly by Christian MPs is we're not allowed to be religious in the UK. You hear that said very often, there's frequently newspaper articles about that. And I'm always slightly baffled by that because I think of Parliament as actually quite a religious place, more religious than the population at large. And that is specific, the Labour, you know, there's the famous quote that Labour owes more to Methodism than to Marx, and the religious strand has been there throughout the history of our party. It is still there, perhaps not as strongly as it was during Tony Blair's time. And for all the stuff about Tony Blair not doing God, he patently obviously did do God. It was very obvious what his religious beliefs were, and it was very obvious that that's what informed. I think his religious beliefs brought him to politics and to left-wing politics, if you can call him left-wing, but brought him to the Labour Party rather than it being the something that was just run concurrent with it. But there was still a sort of very significant number of Labour members of Parliament who have strong religious beliefs. At Easter, for example, someone who's one of the new intake and only in his early 30s, he tweeted something like, "Praise, he has risen, praise him." And I thought, he was somebody I didn't realise was religious, but he obviously was. But you know, he didn't feel embarrassed about making a very overt statement of his religious belief. I find that, particularly at the constituency level, but also I'll come on to my shadow foreign affairs role in a moment, but at constituency level I'm very often asked to go along and do religious things. So there are church services, there's one coming up on 19th of October, which is an annual church service in Bristol to celebrate the legal profession, and I don't understand, I've never been to it, I have no intention, I'm a lawyer as well, but I have no intention of going along to it because I don't think that there's any value in it, you know. I just would feel uncomfortable taking part, I suppose that's the honest truth. On the same day I've been invited to another church and they want to talk about Christian Aid's hunger campaign and do a Q&A afterwards. And I will go along to that because I want to. I'm going out to El Salvador with Christian Aid in September, so I want to talk to the congregation about some of the projects I've seen there. I want to discuss with them that, you know, we have a shared mission, shared beliefs in terms of the hunger projects. I'm quite happy to talk to them about that. If I'm frank with you, I'd rather not go to the church service first, but that's part and parcel of the whole thing, so we'll go along to the church service. But one of the things you find is there's an awful lot of interfaith things going on. When we had the July the 7th bombings, there was an effort to bring together young people from all the different faith communities to discuss their response to it. And there were Muslim kids, there were Sikh kids, there were Hindus, there were even a Buddhist they'd found, Jewish kids. And what I thought was missing was actually kids that didn't believe in anything. Because actually, if you were talking about community cohesion, and particularly about trying to reassure people that the Muslim community shared the same values as other people, it was the kids that didn't go to an organised act of worship on a Sunday that were the ones you really needed to reach out to. And I find that happens over and over again. And yeah, the cenotaph, I always go to Remembrance Sunday, of course, but there's no non-religious element. They're very careful to have a Sikh person reading out something that's relevant to the Sikh community, an imam, the Muslim community, and a rabbi. But there's nothing for the people that don't believe in anything. So I would say that you know, to an extent you have to, you know, I visit gurdwaras, I visit mosques, I've got quite an ethnically diverse constituency. So to an extent you make the compromise as an atheist. I just draw the line at things that I think are purely religious and don't tie in with the values that I have. And sometimes it's very tricky if you have a religious service for troops returning home from service in Afghanistan. You know, you can't not participate in that because that would show disrespect to the troops. But I do wish that there were other ways of showing respect to the troops other than going along to a religious service. So that's at the local level. When it comes to Parliament, as I said, I think that on the Labour side, that there's a long-standing tradition. With the Conservative Party, there's obviously also very much links with the Church of England establishment. And with the most recent intake, the 2010 intake, I think you're starting to see elements of what we have in the States on the Tea Party, the evangelical Christian side. There's some people that are very, I think their religion is more important to them than their politics, and it's very much a driving force, and it leads them to take very hardline stances on certain issues like abortion and assisted dying and other things like that. And as Tom said, the free vote issue is always a thorny one. I was in the Whip's office before we lost the last election, and we had the Human Fertilisation and Embryology Bill go through. And it was very clear that about, I think maybe up to half a dozen members of the Cabinet who were Catholic wouldn't support the hybrid embryo provision in there. And a free vote was allowed. And, you know, I think there's a whole debate to be had about whether you allow free votes because of religious conscience. And it usually is the sort of from people coming from the Catholic side that have a view on that. And when you're up against science, you know, to me the science was very clear that to do that sort of embryonic research would be incredibly useful. I've got a niece with cystic fibrosis, so I felt quite passionate about the need to carry out that sort of research, but we allowed a free vote. We've had votes on abortion, trying to reduce the limits to 20 weeks, and the people who are proposing that will say that they're doing it on a scientific basis. They say that science has changed, fetuses can survive at 20 weeks, and actually the science hasn't changed very much at all. There's no real evidence of that, but they will do it on that basis, whereas actually it's a religious argument. The most obvious example is same-sex marriage, where we had some very, very heated debates. And Ed Miliband at one point was thinking of imposing a whip on that, because that is not just, if you're voting against same-sex marriage, you're not just voting in line with your religious conscience, you're voting just to restrict other people's human rights. And you get this whole argument. Argument about hierarchy of human rights, and human rights are universal. And the most telling debate, there's been quite a lot of debates. There's some very active groups like Christian Solidarity Worldwide and Open Doors who communicate with MPs a lot, and there's an all-party group on freedom of religion or belief, which is lobbies on things like persecution of Christians and other groups. And so there's been a lot of debates in Parliament. It's my job, I was Baroness Farsi's opposite number until she resigned earlier this week. It's my job to respond to those debates. And we had one on human rights in Uganda a year or two ago, which a Unionist MP called. And you would think, you know, everybody knows the big human rights issue in Uganda was at the time was the fact they were trying to introduce a bill to bring in the death penalty for homosexuality. And this MP stood up and talked solely about the persecution of Christians in Uganda. And I've been to Uganda, I've spent a few weeks out there with VSO and I went there with Oxfam, and it's one of the most Christian countries I've ever been to. And the only examples I came up with were an example of a Muslim who'd converted to Christianity, but there was virtually nothing there. And I kept intervening on him and saying, are you going to mention gay rights in a moment? And I knew that he wouldn't, because he was a very hardline Protestant from Northern Ireland and, you know, doesn't have any time for gay rights. So of course I then stood up and my entire speech was about it, and it caused, you know, obviously, you know, he wasn't very happy with that. But then we had a much bigger debate in the chamber itself, that was the Westminster Hall debate, about the persecution of Christians around the world. And both me and the minister that responded on behalf of the government got a very rough ride, because we wouldn't accept that the persecution of Christians was different to the persecution of any other religions or any other groups. And they were calling for special action, so withholding aid paid to countries where there was persecution of Christians. So you imagine saying to Pakistan, we don't really care that there's some problems with the Hindus, you know, being persecuted, but if you're persecuting Christians, we're going to take away our aid funding from you. And, or, you know, to countries that persecute gay people or, horrendous treatment of women, etc., etc. And I was arguing that, you know, there shouldn't be, we should look at countries' human rights record in the round, and they got very, very upset about that. And there was quite a significant number of MPs for a Thursday afternoon when there was no vote that came in on that. So that's the kind of dynamic in Parliament, that's the underlying debate, and I think that we need to thrash out a lot more. I spoke at a conference in Johannesburg to lots of Commonwealth countries about the Commonwealth Charter, which is meant to sign all the Commonwealth countries up to the same standards on human rights, and it's something like about two-thirds of the Commonwealth countries still make it illegal to be homosexual. And the speech, you know, I had to speak for about 20 minutes and it all went fine except those two paragraphs where I spoke about gay rights, and then there was uproar and everyone saying, you're trying to impose your values on us, we're a Christian country. And the interesting thing was, they said, we're a Christian country because you made us Christian. It was us that went to Uganda and to Cameroon and all those countries, and you told us that it was wrong to be gay, and now you're trying to come back, and we've got rid of the colonial masters, you're trying to come back and tell us that you got it wrong first time. And it's quite a difficult one to argue, but I think we do need to continue arguing that. And if I just conclude on that, there is almost like a feeling that if you do argue your non-religious values, you're trying to impose your negativity onto other people, you're trying to interfere with their value system, and that because there's something sort of sacred, again, as Tom says, the fact that it can only be a moral issue if it's rooted in religious faith rather than anything else. I've actually been vegan for something like 23 years and vegetarian longer than that. And that actually to me is part of my identity. You know, I'm a socialist, I'm an atheist, I'm a vegan. And it's not just being fussy about what you eat. It's something a lot more than that. And I've been dying for there to be a vote in Parliament on something like free school milk, so that I can turn around and go to the Whip's office and say, I have a moral right to not vote for free school milk because I don't approve of it. Or, you know, there's a lot of other examples, and it just has never happened. And if it did, it probably wouldn't be important enough to sort of really make a stand. But one day it will happen. It might be a tiny little statutory instrument, but I want to make this, there's two other vegan MPs as well now. But I think it's kind of important because I think you do need to respect people's values across the board. And being vegan, as I chose to do it, and, you know, rather than because a deity has told me to do it, is just as important to me as any other form of religious belief. So we live in hope that one day there'll be the free school milk vote. So thank you.
So we've had an amazing range of opinions and views, and I'm just really pleased that we've actually had such personal experiences as well, which I think has made it really, really come to life. We've covered a huge amount of subjects from what sounds like a sort of, in every kind of field that our panel are kind of working in, actually a growth of religion, or certainly those voices, and maybe a bigger confidence about speaking, particularly around Christianity, and also getting a bit of an insight in that, and to actually how that might work in terms of well-funded lobbies and well-organised lobbies, and kind of what that means in different countries. I mean, in the UK, we are not a secular state. We do have an established church, but we are, to all intents and purposes, I think most people agree, a pretty secular society. But it's interesting, in fact, Kerry just mentioned Baroness Wasi, who resigned last week, and one of her titles was Minister for Faith and Community. Instead of just scrapping that role, they have now got another person in as Minister for Faith, both of whom are very outspoken opponents of secularism. The current one, Eric Pickles, who's probably well known to quite a few people here, has been very disparaging of atheists. As well, particularly, so not just secularism, but also atheists. So I just wonder whether, particularly before we go to questions, whether the panel has kind of particularly anything they wanted to pick up on what other people said. I know sort of Tom went first. So
The Blair stuff I think was interesting because, as you pointed out, even though Alistair Campbell interrupted them and said we don't do God, it's a sort of matter of, I suppose, from a sort of the perspective of his aides, as it were. No, we don't go there. Yet, of course, as Kerry said, Blair was quite obviously very, very Christian. Pushed through, I think, the biggest expansion of faith schools we'd seen since the establishment of the modern education system. But I do think it was still, he was kind of doing that in sort of legislative terms, but still, I think, was restrained in quite how evangelical he was about his beliefs when he was making his speech. Because, as I say, I do think we find it a bit strange and uncomfortable when politicians come out and speak such strongly. So I just wanted to make that observation.
Great. Do we have some questions? We've got loads of questions, fantastic. And we've got some microphones, so if we go to this gentleman first. And it would be great if you could say who you are and where you come from.
Yes, my name is Josh Kuczynski, and I'd like to say, as you say, who I am. I'm an ethical atheist, which to my mind makes me a humanist. People are free to choose the labels they wish, but anybody who says that they are an ethical atheist or agnostic is a humanist. And I think it is useful, these labels, but they're labels of choice. I'm also the humanist chair of the Brent, London Borough of Brent, Standing Advisory Council on Religious Education. There aren't many, it's a statutory committee which is set up locally in every local authority, and there are very few, but there are some humanist chairs of these organisations, and so I work with other people of other beliefs and religions. My question, just one last point about the United States, but of course the Constitution of the United States is a phenomenal humanist document, you know, part of our history. The fight that the AHA is doing to make people recognize it for that and to abide by it is extraordinary. The question I have is about children and the need, it seems to me, for us all to recognize the international law, which is the Convention on the Rights of the Child, which is signed up to and agreed to by almost every country in the world, with two notable exceptions, I believe. One is the United States of America. But I think that this is the question. Why do we not follow what is our international obligations, those of us who have signed up to this convention, to promote the convention to the population, to educate children about it in schools, and to have them know their rights? I know one of the problems in the United States is corporal punishment, is the chastisement of children as a human right of Christian parents, generally. Anyway, I think I've gone on long enough, but I'm particularly attached to the idea of supporting the Convention on the Rights of the Child.
Yes, if we can do that in the United States, that would be incredible. It's not just corporal punishment, as I mentioned before. It's vaccinations. It's seriously. I mean, Christian Scientist children just die. They die because their parents do not take them to the hospital, and those parents do not have to go to jail. They consider it a religious exemption. Their religious right says that they don't believe in that. They don't have to believe in it for their children. And this is a serious problem if we're really concerned about children, if we're concerned about their rights. And so if there's any kind of influence that we can do in that area, I think that's definitely something that we need to do more of, absolutely.
Is that the particular reason why you think the States hasn't signed up for that? Is there much feeling around and with kind of American politicians that is something they want to sign up to, or is that sort of seen as a...
I think that there's a more stronger belief that parents have rights over their children, that family is a private issue, that the way you raise your children is a freedom that parents are granted. That's stronger. You know, America's like, freedom, freedom, freedom. You know, it's really true. They really emphasize that, except that they don't know what that means. They don't know how to explain it. And they don't recognize that children should have the freedom too. Like, I think that we would all agree, even humanists and atheists, parents who have children, and in fact, I was just talking to somebody over at lunch just a couple of days ago, and I said, oh, well, that's a humanist child there. And she goes, oh, no, my son is going to explore beliefs. He's going to explore religion, explore things that are out there, and then he will decide. And that's what all parents should do, but religion doesn't allow that. And I think it's just great that humanists do that, and we allow our children to be more open to the possibility of things that are out there.
I mean, it's often... people will describe their child as, oh, it's a Christian child or a Muslim child. Well, there's no such thing as a Christian child or a Muslim child, or even an atheist child. You haven't decided yet. And I think children have a fundamental right to be able to explore other beliefs and other ideas and to come to their own conclusions about what it is that they believe in. And I think we have to get away from this. It goes into other areas as well, not just the right of the child, but the idea of religious rights trumping everything else, as it were. And they don't. Religious rights are not more important than gay rights. They're not more important than the rights of ethnic minorities. They're not more important than the rights of women. And they're not more important than the rights of children. And one of the problems I have, particularly with faith schools, which is something I've been campaigning against for years and years and years, is the idea of putting children together in one school based on the religious belief of their parents. And this is not true in all cases, because there are some faith schools that are very diverse, but I think we're moving in the wrong direction on this. And putting children together just with the same kinds of children, not allowing them to learn about other religions and other cultures, certainly not allowing them to learn about those on equal footing with the religion of the school. I think that the rights of the child would dictate that those children have a right to know about other beliefs. Children are not the property of their parents. We don't allow parents to do anything with their children. There comes a point where we say, no, that's not acceptable. And we have to decide where that line is.
Yep.
It was under the previous Labour government that we enshrined the Human Rights Act into our law. So, and I know that the Labour Party particularly is very, very strong on human rights and uses the human rights language. I mean, in your perspective, I mean, in terms of thinking about the rights of the child, is that as important, I suppose, as rights of human rights of adults? Or?
Yeah, of course it is. In fact, in some ways, more so because you're acting on behalf of people who can't speak up for themselves. And the Human Rights Act is under attack on a daily basis in Parliament. There are systematic attempts to rubbish it apart from... There's one Tory MP, actually, he's like archaeosceptic, and then he wasn't allowed to bring his... I think it was a pug or a Jack Russell. His dog get him to work, and he tried to claim that was a...
breach.
No, I think it was Matthew Offord.
Right.
Yeah, but anyway, he claimed it was a breach of his human rights, which is quite hilarious, really. But it sort of shows that they'll rely on the Human Rights Act when it sort of affects them, you know, bringing their little dog into work. And I think he carried on doing it. He was banned from doing it. But that's just an aside. But we've got Sadiq Khan, who's our Shadow Secretary of State for Justice, has been doing a lot of work recently on trying to shore up the argument for. Human rights. There's a Labour campaign for human rights that's been set up as well. And I think we have to be far more vocal in defending that and defending the universality of it and not sort of picking and choosing and not setting one group against the other. It's, sometimes there will be conflicts here. Do you remember the B&B case where the religious couple, the gay couple were actually from my constituency? And that is a classic example of in some ways you could say that the human rights of the gay couple trumps the human rights of the B&B owners. So it is a very difficult argument to have, but you would think that in that hierarchy children have got to be somewhere near the top of that.
I'm going to open up to questions again. I've got a gentleman just at the front here.
Thank you very much for an excellent discussion. My name is Vikas Gora. I come from Atheist Center India. We are celebrating 75 years this year. So. We're talking about a country which is so unique in terms of diversity and religions, and so there is always a space for non-belief in India, which I feel really proud when I hear these conversations, that interestingly, developing countries are more advanced in secularism and developed countries are more medieval in their beliefs. And that's a struggle I undergo when I see the struggle you're having in terms of getting the word atheism or humanism getting recognized. Whereas in India, in the Article 51H of the Indian Constitution, which it says it's the fundamental duty of every citizen of India to promote humanism, scientific temper, spirit of inquiry and reform.
Great.
So, I won't take the pride of it, but I will definitely say that I'm proud that it is part of the Constitution. Whether it's been put into action or not is a different conversation. But definitely it is present in, and that's what Atheist Center uses it for when we do our lobbying. And my question is, in why is there so much of struggle of getting recognition to humanism and atheism in the developed world? Whereas in Africa and Asia, we have much more recognition of the term atheist. It's, in India, there are only two words. Either you're a Gnostic, atheist, or you're a believer. So there are only two options. And we find it so interesting to see why is there still a struggle.
Sorry, the microphone cut out, but the question was really about why I guess in the kind of countries that we're sort of represented on this panel, why is the sort of terms humanism and atheism so difficult to get represented or acknowledged?
Yes, here in the developed world, whereas it is recognised in the developing and so-called underdeveloped.
Julie, did you want to?
I don't know if it works.
No.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hey. Hi. Well, I think I would say at first that people don't know about humanism. They don't know, I mean, in Belgium, for example, even my friends, I mean, they don't know what is humanism. They always ask me, what do you define by humanist? I mean, what do you do in your work? I mean, I can't really understand. And so I think that there is a problem that people don't really understand what it means. It's not popular enough, and we really have to make an effort to go to citizens and explain even better what it is. Because, I mean, most of people are humanists without knowing it, and so it should be maybe not necessarily being proud of, but just to explain what it is. And second, I forgot my second point. Okay.
Does anyone else have a comment to make?
Okay, we'll go to. So I love the Constitution.
Yeah.
We don't even have one.
Can I keep on? Yeah, the second thing is that in Belgium it happens a lot. And in developed countries also, that people don't see the necessity to fight for what has been acquired, like fundamental rights, which were, adopted, like abortion rights, like in Belgium, as in Asia, gay wedding, etc., and that it, like most of people don't see that you have to be very careful and fight to keep these rights. So,
is the same here?
My name is Saxon Spence, and I come from Devon in the United Kingdom. And for a long time, was an elected Labour local politician. So I come to humanism as a socialist first, and then a humanist. But I was so pleased to hear Maggie's robust defence of the need to get involved in politics, because I'd like to turn the question round. Should politics matter to humanists? And are there opportunities? We have a general election coming up next year. Should not there be a humanist manifesto put before the political parties when there are general elections?
Really interesting question. I'm going to ask the whole panel to respond to that one, actually.
Can I just say, I think the problem is you don't want a humanist manifesto that is just a list of things where we don't want religion coming into play. So, and that, I think, is the difficulty in formulating one, because it would, if you're talking about things like abolishing the compulsory act of worship in schools, you know, some of the sort of secular things or whatever, I'm trying to think of how you would pull it together. and not just have a sort of fairly bland statement of values that nobody could disagree with. So I think, you know, I think it's a good idea. I just think it would need quite a lot of work. But yeah, maybe the Indian example, you know, we have so many arguments. I actually was interviewed recently by some scientists are putting together a group of scientists to try to make politicians better informed about the impact of science. And I said, well, the problem is you'll find MPs will look for the science that already supports their argument. There's so much science out there, you'd always find a scientist, look at something like the badger cull even, you know, you'll find one report that says, yeah, you know, go for it, kill them, and most of them. You struggle to find that, actually, but you know, in terms of perhaps sort of support for rationalism, evidence-based politics, and, you know, things where it's been sort of shown by research, but then also tied into some of the fundamental statements of universal human rights as well. I think perhaps that might get us somewhere.
Yeah, I think that, first, manifesto is a problematic word in the United States, tied to communism, which is bad to the United States. So that's one change I would make, to change it, not call it a manifesto. But I do think that it would be very simple for us to, I mean, and I completely agree with what you're saying, you know, where that we absolutely have to get in politics. You know, there have been a couple of sessions about building humanist communities. And a lot of groups in the United States are really more focused on communities. They want to be social. They want to gather people together. They want to have children's programs. And I think this is great. American Human Association supports that. We encourage it. But sometimes they think, well, we only want to focus on that, and we don't want to focus on politics at all. That's something else. We should leave it to other groups. And when you leave it to other groups, you're leaving it to the religious right to take over. That's what you are doing when you do not get politically involved, when you don't vote, when you don't donate to political campaigns. You are just going to make it easier for religious Christianity, essentially making it a theocracy. It's going to be a theocracy. You're going to wake up one day, and that's it. Everybody's a Christian, and then they're going to start forcing the beliefs on atheists and humanists. And that's the issue. That's the reason why we really need to get involved in politics.
I hope you've already joined Labour Humanists, which Naomi chairs, and I think does excellent work, and particularly recently actually at the National Policy Forum, action on particular issues of battle towards. I mean, like you, I'm a socialist, and then I became a humanist after that, and I think in part because socialism is primarily an economic way of thought, whereas humanism has a much wider ethical framework to it. I used to talk only really in terms of socialism, and now I talk about both. I talk about humanism a lot more than I used to, precisely because I think it's important that we as humanists in politics express why and how we've arrived at the moral and ethical decisions that we have. So I hope that more politicians who are humanists will speak up. And we've got an all-party parliamentary group, I think, a humanist group.
Yes.
Which is great, and I would always encourage humanist MPs to actually speak up and get involved and join and to be very open about their beliefs.
You guys are so lucky. I'm like, I just want one in Congress, one person.
I think Peter Bottomley, a Tory MP who's a Christian, actually joined the humanist group. He said to give moral support.
There's a small group of old school lefties, for want of a better word, that are the most vocal humanist things. So people like Kelvin Hopkins, Paul Flynn, whatever, I think Jeremy Corbyn. And other people. Yeah, they're all guys with the beards, yeah, that's the qualifying criteria. And I think I could tell you who the religious MPs are. And occasionally there'll be someone else you think, oh, I didn't realise they were a Christian or whatever, but I could name you lots and lots of religious MPs. I'd be hard pushed to absolutely say for certain who the atheists are, apart from those people. And there'll be one or two people I've had conversations with. And I know that there's some, you know, particularly some of the female MPs from the 2010 intake do feel very strongly about it. But I found that out by having private conversations with them. And I think that's an issue, is that they don't want to offend, you know, there is a risk that if you start talking about it, you're immediately seen as offending some of your constituents. And I think we need to, if you look at who yeah, I don't, you simply don't have it in the States, but the very first thing we do as we become an MP is you have to swear an oath. And you can either swear an oath on the, you know, on a religious oath, or you can affirm before you take up office. And if you don't do that oath, then you, it raises an interesting issue actually for Republicans, because you have to swear, you don't get the choice of doing it to the Queen or not. But, and if you look at the number of MPs, there's a lot of MPs that will affirm, but then they don't actually speak out about the fact that they've chosen, you know, they obviously don't have religious faith. They do keep quite quiet about it.
The late Tony Banks famously used to hold his fingers up crossed like that when he swore allegiance to the Queen.
No, he did it behind his back.
I always saw a photo of him doing this.
He got into trouble for that though.
In the kind of the question was really kind of around, should there be a humanist manifesto? I mean, in kind of your work, do you think that would be helpful?
Yeah, at the UTF we got one for the European elections, but the main problem is that basically a humanist can have a view on every topic. I mean, it's very wide, and so in for practical reason, when you go to MPs, you have to go with somebody more focused, and so you have to choose the topics. And so it's really, I think it's really hard for humanists to really choose the topics they want to promote first, because you cannot speak about everything in your manifesto. And it's easier for LGBT rights organization or women's rights organizations to be more focused on their topics. But for humanists, it's very wide, and it's always something which goes back to us, like, we are quite general humanists. What do you defend? You're so general. I mean, you have so many topics you want to talk about. You have a humanist view on so many topics. So that's the main point. I mean, difficulty we meet in politics, I would say.
Thank you. Do you have a question? Yes.
Hi there, my name is Jennifer Button. I'm from Scotland and a member of the Humanist Society of Scotland, and I have the privilege of being a celebrant with the Humanist Society of Scotland, which gives me a platform 3 times a week, whether it's at a graveside or in a crematorium, to explain to people what humanism is. And I'm very proud of my humanism. I'm a humanist first. I'm also a humanist scout leader, which has proved to be very difficult, because I'm a humanist first. And people say to me, do you have a humanist scout group? I've got one of the biggest scout groups in Scotland, because my group's fully inclusive and always has been. I'm very fortunate to come from a country now where 37% of the population do not have religion. We're the biggest percentage of the population. But the Humanist Society of Scotland, what we've done with the Scottish Parliament very recently is our equal marriage bill. You can't have an equal marriage yet in Scotland, as you can in England, but it's not quite equal in England. It's equal but different. In Scotland, come January, due to the Humanist Society of Scotland, it will be equal and equal. And what I'd finally like to say is, please don't feel that you're forcing humanism down people's throats. I carry hard copies of the Amsterdam Declaration in my handbag. So after I've married someone, after I've buried someone, people say to me, what is humanism? And I can give them a definite answer. There's no wishy-washy answer. It's a good answer, and it's a positive answer. Please do it.
My name is Bård Hallberg, and I'm from Norway, and I'm on the board of the European Humanist Federation. When I joined the Norwegian Humanist Association back in the 1980s and started reading the membership magazine, I wondered, have I joined a left socialist party? Because all the members there, except for me, were socialists. And when I turned up at the seminar for the young conservative students at their university and I told them I was a humanist, I could have just landed on the moon. Such people did not exist. back in the late 90s, I ran for town council candidate, and I was the politician who was the most stricken. We have a system in Norway where you take a party's list, and if you don't like the candidate, you just take the pen and strike him out. And this made a record turnout for the Conservative Party in my town. So actually, the best thing I ever did for my party was to be stricken out. And of course, it's done right there and then, but it's the only way a democracy can work. And that was my little speech.
We just have a few minutes left, so I'm going to try and take some quick questions. In fact, we've got two people here. I wonder if we could just sort of take one question, then the other, and then just see.
John Blake from the Spanish branch. I am a card-carrying member of the Labour Party. My question is about party politics. At the AGM of the BHA 2 weeks ago, one person stormed out because a group of lefties put forward a proper motion for debate by the association, and he's having no part of it. So my question to you is, how is our leaders, I mean, bear in mind there's no overt Conservative Party member on the panel this morning, how do you tread this fine dividing line between left-wing, right-wing in America and in the UK and the EU without splitting the association?
Thank you. And I'll take this lady's question as well.
I'm Jenny Middleton from the New Zealand Humanist Society. I'm interested in economic issues. Can you comment on my question? Does humanism have a role in advocating the dismantling of neoliberal economics? And I'm thinking of Professor Guy Standing's book, two books, The Precariat, A New and Dangerous Class, and the one just published, Precariat Chapter. Thank you.
Thank you. Actually, two fairly related questions, actually, about kind of politics and wider issues in humanism. So I don't know who wants to...
Can I? One of the differences that we saw post-2010 was a lot of, a fair number of women MPs elected on the Conservative side, and they've never had, you know, there was 101 women MPs in 1997, but the vast majority of them were on the Labour side. And what had always happened until 2010 is women's rights issues, women's issues, to use the shorthand, were very much seen as a left issue. And then suddenly, you got in 2010, you had this new intake of women that probably most of them would define themselves as feminist. We suddenly had to sort of rethink that whole agenda, because whereas you thought there was a women's issue agenda, there wasn't. There was distinct left and right positions on it. It comes to things like childcare. Labour would support free state-funded nurseries for children. The Tories were talking about tax breaks for people in work. Yeah. So they're very different issues. And I think in some ways, we have to sort of think about that on the humanist side and on what you were saying about fighting the neoliberal agenda, because the left has traditionally, as I said, with the all-party humanist group, that debate has been dominated by thinkers on the left. And I think we do have to recognise that there needs to be some space for thinkers who don't, you know, who aren't of the left, that from different political dimensions. So, you know, there will be atheists who really, really strongly believe in free markets and the onward march of capitalism. So I think, you know, you could say, you know, my values, I would certainly say that the humanist values I've got and the ones that Maggie talked about would be completely, would find that sort of thing completely abhorrent. But I think, you know, there will be people out there that don't share that view.
I think, we did a survey of our members not too long ago, and we discovered that, you know, 50% of our members identified as Democrats. You know, the rest identified as independents, and then we had something like 3% that voted Republican or identified as a Republican, and of course they vote Republican based on the economic issues and not the social issues. They've told us that before. And we do have to carry a balance between what we talk about, and this is kind of like what you were saying, Julie, in that we do have to focus on a small number of issues for now. We can't say everything about, you know, we can apply humanism to all kinds of issues. But our focus in the United States has to be church-state separation, because that's the real big issue for us. And then, of course, human rights related to women, to LGBT movements. And so we don't talk about economic issues much, But there are ways in which we can support it, but we just don't make it a huge priority. And then we do have to recognize that we have some libertarians, some Republicans that do consider themselves humanists. But that's also why we have other organizations in the US. So we have American Humanist Association, we have American Atheists, we have the Center for Inquiry, we have other groups that that really don't take a stand on that issue or focus on the sort of libertarian right side. And so you have a choice between the types of organizations that you can join in the US.
That's it. I don't think the BHA certainly is ever going to foray into the economy, for example. I mean, I wouldn't support that. I think that, for me, socialism and humanism go together very well. Personally, I think they fit together very well, and there's a lot of overlap. But you know, humanism isn't an economic philosophy. It's something different to that. I do think it's no coincidence, though, that there are an awful lot of people in the Labour Party and on the left who are involved in humanism. I do know conservatives who are humanists as well. I think the interesting thing about Parliament now on the conservative side is they're losing, or they've lost, so many of the sort of traditional one nation conservatives, the conservatives that tend to be more, people like Ken Clark, who tend to be much more, have a much more sort of social conscience about things. And there's an increasing number of these sort of very libertarian, as you were saying earlier, Tea Party type politicians for whom, who don't have that same view and for whom I think humanism wouldn't necessarily be for them. But you know, I certainly would welcome people from all sides on politics coming to humanism.
I just, as my kind of experience as a political campaigner as well, I just feel like we need people from all different political perspectives to be voicing their humanist beliefs and their atheism, speaking out. Atheism is absolutely not the preserve of people on the left or liberals, although humanist values tend to, you know, in terms of support of things like human rights and individual freedoms, of course, that is the more liberal, small L perspective. There's plenty on the party political right who would also support those values. And just my kind of thing, I think that we as humanists in terms of politics aren't going to get very far if it is actually seen as something which is just the preserve of socialists or liberal democrats or people, you know, on that side of the spectrum. So I would actually sort of make a plea for trying to support as many people as possible.
I suspect Conservative MPs find it much harder to speak out because they're very answerable to their constituency associations that tend to be elderly, very establishment, you know, the sort of twin set and pearls, like whatever, who, and they probably have more pressure on them to actually, you know, go to church service, and they just by nature of the sort of constituency they represent. So I'm not aware of any Conservative MP. I wouldn't be able to point a finger and say who the atheists are.
There
must be some. There's obviously some.
We are actually just running out of time. I just wanted to give Judy, just in case you had a sort of point to make on that kind of issue.
Well, at the European Parliament, on the issue we would promote, like, which are mainly societal issues like women's rights, LGBT rights, research, non-discrimination, freedom of expression, etc. We work both with socialists, we work with socialist MEPs, we work with radical left, we work with liberal also, liberal MEPs, and they don't have the same views on economical issues, but they meet on the issue we want to promote first. So that that can be, maybe, like, we can build alliances also. But we have the greatest difficulties to get even moderate conservatives. Because in the main conservative group at the European Parliament, you have a very, very conservative people from Poland, from Hungary, etc. But you have also like the French conservative MEP, which are considered to be the left side of the right wing. And it's very difficult to get them. It's very difficult because they have this group line to match. And they are really reluctant to rebel from this line, and because in France also with all this debate on gay marriage, etc., it's a very political debate, and they are very afraid of slipping from the political line, the national political line.
Okay. Thank you, but I'm conscious that we are now 3 minutes over time, so I'm going to draw this to a close. I know we had tons of more questions, actually. So just want to say thank you very much once more to our panel.